Hello learners, welcome back to the world of economics. Today, I am going to take you through demand, a very important foundation topic in microeconomic theory. We shall be dealing with the difference between demand and desire, factors affecting individual demand, the meaning and definition of demand, how an individual demand schedule is prepared, the law of demand, the individual demand curve, and market demand. Let us begin by understanding the meaning of demand. Demand, as we all know, refers to the quantity of a commodity that a consumer is willing and able to buy at each possible price during a given period of time. This, as we all know, is what demand is. It's important now to understand the components of demand. The components of demand are price of the commodity, the quantity of the commodity, and the given period of time for which the quantity is demanded. How is demand different from desire? Desire means a mere wish to have a commodity. For example, the desire of a poor for a big house, having just rupees 1000 in his pocket. So how is this poor person able to convert his desire into demand? It is not possible. We must understand that individual demand refers to the quantity of a commodity that an individual buyer is able and willing to buy at given price per unit of time. Now, this brings us to the next understanding of what really contributes or constitutes to demand for a commodity. Here we have these factors, which we will call them later as, first and foremost, price of the commodity. The price of related goods. Thirdly, the income of the buyer. And fourthly, tastes and preferences of the buyer. And we club even fashion into it at times, and it is fashion as well. So fashion can be a part of tastes and preferences as well. Let us now understand each of these factors that affect demand one by one. We shall take price of related goods first and foremost. Now, what do we mean by related goods? As the diagram here specifies, related goods are either substitute goods or complementary goods. When the change in the price of a good causes change in demand of other goods, then both the goods are known as related goods. Let us understand substitute goods and complementary goods separately. Substitute goods, these refers to those goods which can be used in place of one another to satisfy a particular want. As shown here, it is tea and coffee. Can you name a few more? Yes, substitute goods can be car and scooter, it can be refill pen and a ball pen, and so on. So these are substitute goods that can be substituted in place of each other to satisfy the same want. Let us now move on to complementary goods. What are complementary goods? Complementary goods refers to those goods which are used together to satisfy a particular want. You have it right. Your most important gadget these days, the mobile phone and the SIM. There are other examples also, car and petrol, or car and diesel, and there can be pen and refill, and so on. Let us now understand how they are able to affect the demand for the commodity. That is, how the price of substitute goods affects the demand of the good in question. When the price of a good changes, the demand of its substitute goods changes in the same direction. When the price of coffee, for instance, increases, demand for tea will increase, and vice versa. So, what can we say about the price and demand direction of change? They both change in the same direction. We can analyze similarly for complementary goods, as shown, car and petrol. Change in price of a good inversely affects the demand of its complementary goods. This is the relationship between complementary goods, that the change in price inversely affects the demand for its complementary goods. An example here is when the price of petrol increases, the demand for car decreases, and vice versa. This is because when price of petrol increases, it becomes dearer, and so the car which runs on petrol also tends to become dearer. So this is the way that there is an inverse relationship between price of a good and the demand of its complementary good. Let us now come to the second factor affecting demand for a commodity, and that is the income of the consumer. Let us see how this happens. Does change in income affect various goods differently? Yes, as the slide here shows, it does. We can see that a normal good has a positive income effect. That is, when the income of a buyer increases, the buyer will buy more units of a normal good, and vice versa. Examples of normal goods are fruits, vegetables, sweets, etc. There are other goods as well who behave differently when income rises. These are known as inferior goods. Inferior goods having negative income effect, that is, when income of buyer increases, the demand of inferior goods decreases, and vice versa. These goods are not high in our priority. They are very low, and as our income rises, we move out of the consumption of these goods to better substitute goods. Examples are jowar, bajra, and toned milk. Normal goods have a direct relationship with income and demand, whereas inferior goods have an inverse relationship between income and demand. This brings us to the third factor, which is tastes and preferences. Now, how do tastes and preferences, and as previously said, even fashion, affect the demand for a commodity? Demand for those goods increases which are preferred by the buyer or which are in fashion. So, goods which are in fashion will have an increased demand. On the other hand, demand for those goods decreases, that is, falls, which are not preferred by the buyer or which are out of fashion. A very good instance of this is, a person may have a garage sale of all outdated goods. Is the person able to generate demand for those goods? Very little, because those goods are generally out of fashion or not so preferred by the consumers. So, tastes and preferences are directly related to demand for a good. If tastes and preferences are in favor of a commodity, then demand will increase. If tastes and preferences are not in favor of the commodity, then demand for that commodity may fall. Hence, we can say that tastes and preferences determine the demand for a commodity. Here is an example. If Monica prefers jeans and tops in comparison to salwar and kameez, her demand for jeans and tops will increase. Let us now come to the most important factor affecting the demand for a commodity, and this is the price of the good in question. This relationship holds so true and for most of the commodities, and that is why it is also known as the law of demand. To understand the law of demand, let us first understand the individual demand schedule. The individual demand schedule refers to a tabular statement showing various quantities of a commodity an individual buyer is willing to buy at various levels of price during a given period of time. As shown here, this is an individual demand schedule. That is, in a tabular form, you have price for the commodity, per unit price, and you have simultaneously the quantity demanded of that commodity. Going back to the law of demand, let us understand that the law of demand states that there is an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded of a commodity. That is, if price of a commodity falls, its quantity demanded increases, and if price of the commodity rises, its quantity demanded will fall. Other things remaining constant. This has also been shown with this diagram. When the price goes up, quantity demanded will go down. And when the price goes down, quantity demanded will go up. This is what we mean by inverse relationship. And this relationship can also be plotted as an individual demand curve. The price is considered on the y-axis and quantity demanded or purchased on the x-axis. As shown here, price is on the y-axis here and quantity demanded on the x-axis. Let us now consider the purchase of mangoes by a consumer named Varsha over a period of time and make a demand schedule and a demand curve from the data we collect from the market. I'm sure many of you have done some projects in economics or have been asked to do these projects, and this is one such activity you can take up. We have to understand that income, tastes and preferences, and price of related goods remains unchanged as we study only price of the commodity. If the price of mangoes is rupees 50 per kg, Varsha buys 2 kg of mangoes. If the price of mangoes rises to rupees 60 per kg, Varsha buys only 1.5 kg of mangoes for a week. If price falls to rupees 40 per kg, she is willing to buy more, that is 2.5 kg of mangoes for a week. Can we interpret this in terms of demand? This means when price is rupees 50 per kg, Varsha's demand for mangoes is 2 kg per week at a price of rupees 60 per kg, her demand is only 1.5 kg per week, and at a price of rupees 40 per kg, her demand is 2.5 kg. When price rises, quantity demanded falls, and vice versa. This situation, we can write it in a tabular form. We had taken up these three instances, and others have also been added so that we get a good table and a demand curve. If we plot these points on the two axes and join these points together, what do we get? We get the demand curve for mangoes. As shown here, the same data which was shown before, I go back, has been plotted as a curve. And so this way we get the demand curve. Kindly note the shape of the demand curve. It is downward sloping. That is, it is falling downwards from the left to the right. And this is due to the inverse relationship between price and demand of a commodity. I hope the shape of the demand curve is very clear to each one of you. Now, why does this inverse relationship arise? At this level, it is just sufficient for you all to know that the shape of the demand curve is downward sloping from left to the right because of three explanations. First is the law of diminishing marginal utility, the income effect, and the substitution effect. When we go to the next level of education, we shall discuss these in detail. We also need to understand the market demand for a commodity. Market demand refers to the quantity of a commodity that all consumers are willing and able to buy at each possible price during a given period of time. Naturally, every market has more than one buyer, and we have to consolidate their demand or bring it together, and that is what is known as market demand. The factors affecting market demand are number of buyers, the climatic conditions facing the buyers, and the distribution of income and wealth. With this, learners, we come to the end of the topic demand, and I hope that today's presentation will see you sailing better in the topic and generate more interest in the subject of economics. Thank you, and all the best.